Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As a matter of introduction, my name is W.H. Verdery, and Judge Caudill has appointed me to sit as Judge Pro Hack in this case. And I appreciate you being here because it is a good idea, I think, in this case, to start with a status conference. This is not a formal hearing. There will be no witnesses. I don't intend on accepting any evidence. What I wanted to do was to get everyone together and let me hear from each of you as to what you see the status of the case to be. And then I will have some questions to ask and give me a better understanding of things. And then my goal would be is when we part today is that we will enter in effect or start gathering information for what is the pretrial order. So I'll know about how many witnesses we have, about how many hours we might need to reserve the courtroom. So we'll have some matters at the end of the hearing that I would like to take up with you when we get to that point. I would ask if you have any phones or any other equipment other than our video equipment today, please turn those off. There'll be a point later on, I hope I have done my phone correctly, where it's on silent, but I've left it on because when we get through, before we go through a week or two of trying to coordinate all our schedules, I'm going to try to get a hearing date set while we're here, so that will meet everyone's schedule. Hopefully sometime in November, unless some other things appear. So with that, I suppose it would be appropriate to hear from Ms. Anderson or Ms. Freeman, just to kind of state where you see the status of the case, please, Ms. Anderson, and let me know what issues you think we might be addressing.
Thank you, Your Honor. I will try to be as brief as possible. And again, Mr. Talon apologizes for not being able to be here. He's on the bench right now in Magistrate Court in Forsyth County. My firm, both Mr. Talon and myself, represent Ms. Freeman. She is administrator for the estate of Lemuel Pruitt. There is a companion case that was previously heard in the Superior Court here in Habersham County, which has now been resolved by a final order on motion for summary judgment. I have a copy of that order, as some of the issues that are present in this case have already been discussed and decided in the Superior Court case. If the court would like to see that, I do have a copy of that order.
I would love to see that. I'm not familiar with the Superior Court case. I would love to see it.
Your Honor, I'll just show the opposing party so she can see what I'm bringing to you. May I approach?
Certainly. What did the summary judgment decide, Ms. Anderson?
There was a, if Your Honor will allow me, I'll just briefly describe the facts, and that will, I think the order will make a little more sense. Mr. Pruitt, upon his death, his wife transferred all of Mr. Pruitt's, I'll say he transferred a parcel of property, or she transferred a parcel of property and some stock into her name. That was Judy Farmer Pruitt, the defendant in this case, or not the defendant, I'm sorry. Miss Nichols is the administrator for Judy Pruitt's estate, and that's how the parties are all here today. So Judy Farmer Pruitt took all of these assets and transferred them directly into her name. The decedent in this case has four children who should have received something from the estate. So instead of Ms. Pruitt transferring everything into her name, she should have had at least two-thirds of the estate set aside for the children. So what we did, we filed a lawsuit to set aside the transfer of property and to recover the value of the stock. We won on both grounds on motion for summary judgment in the Superior Court. We also won attorney's fees. So the property was the deed that transferred the property over to Judy Farmer Pruitt was set aside. So the property is now back in the estate of Lemuel Pruitt. And there is a court order for $8,000 and some odd dollars against the estate of Judy Farmer Pruitt. So that's essentially what happened in the Superior Court. It's all in a nutshell. It's a very a view from 10,000 feet. The way that comes into play today is the status of the case in this court, in the probate court, is that my client is trying to sell that parcel of property so that the assets from that sale can be distributed. It's not a very expensive parcel. The estate expects to get about $25,000 from the proceeds. We have a potential buyer. We have negotiated with that buyer to essentially wait on closing until we receive an order from the probate court on this issue. We filed a petition for leave to sell the property. The only objection is from Ms. Nichols, and I have copies. There should be a copy in the official clerk's file, but I also have a copy if the court needs to see her objection.
I have it, thank you.
We, of course, I know this is not a hearing on the petition or the objection, but right. We think that the objection is not founded, and that we should be able to sell the property. There are other complicating factors. Ms. Nichols has filed a lien on the property. We don't believe there was standing to file the lien. It clouds the title and prevents us from being able to actually sell the property and therefore to receive the funds to distribute to the heirs. Additionally, there is a second lien on the property that was filed by the Georgia Department of Community Health. Their counsel is here today. We have spoken to them. We have an agreement with them where we think we can work out a way to sell the property, to release the lien, sell the property, and get those funds into the estate to be able to pay debts and distribute to the heirs. We have negotiated a couple of different options, and I will let Ms. O'Toole speak to that as well, but my client would be fine with an escrow agreement, putting the funds from the sale of property, if the lien should be released, putting those funds into escrow, pending an order from the court determining where the funds should go. We don't have any objection to that. We just want to make sure the property gets sold so that there are funds to distribute. We would also consent to a court order if the court wanted to determine where the funds should be distributed before those are distributed. We would consent to an order in that line of thinking. So, Your Honor, really we're just here today. We're hoping to sell the property, get those funds into the estate, and make sure they're distributed appropriately.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Anderson.
Thank you.
Okay, Ms. Nichols, what do I need to hear from you?
I would appreciate if Ms. Anderson would go back to the very beginning and explain it, and it might make more sense to you. Kathy does not have powers to bring any lawsuit against me. She's only an administrator. Just like me, I was never granted any powers to sign, convey, arbitrate, do anything. I was never granted those, just like Kathy. As if she's only an administrator, I am only an administrator. But we need to go back to the beginning, and that's what I wish you would address the court. Go back to the very beginning of when her father died. Where were they?
Let me stop just a moment. We have a single administrator or a personal representative, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Because as Ms. Nichols is saying, they're both serving, and I'm a bit...
I'm only an administrator. I have no powers to do anything.
You're administrator of Ms. Pruitt's estate?
Of my mother's estate,
yes. I'm with you. Okay.
Okay. My stepfather died 11 months before my mother.
I understand.
I assumed everything was done. They knew they were at their father's funeral. They knew he passed away. They had probated their mother's estate, I think, in 2003 or 2002, whenever your mother died. I have a copy of that petition as well. So you knew what the probate process was. I didn't. So basically, for 2 years, where were y'all? You abandoned. I'm being an administrator of both estates, basically.
Your Honor.
Well, Let me kind of set the template here just a little bit, okay? I understand that there's a petition to sell. I understand that there's a factor with community health being involved. I understand that you filed a lien. I understand that there was an executor's deed, which appears in the chain of title, which we'll discuss in a little bit, and your personal lien that was filed. So what I'd like to do, if I could, Ms. Nichols, is hear from you and that petition to sell, and then you file something that disagrees with that. If you could just set forth to me why you disagree with the petition to sell.
It's
to sell.
In my objection.
Yes, ma'am. I understand. I've read them. And this is just preliminary.
I understand, but it's in, everything's in my objection. That property is still in my mother's name.
Did the summary judgment address that executor's deed that went from her mother to her mother?
Yes, Your Honor. I believe that's what was set aside by the motion for the order on summary judgment.
That's what I'm told, Ms. Nichols, and I had a query in my own mind when I reviewed the file that there was a deed from your mother as executor to her individually, and apparently that's been set aside, so that ground apparently is not.
I don't have a copy of that deed being set aside, Your Honor. It's still in my mother's name.
Okay.
Which, well, she didn't convey that property.
Okay, I'm understanding from you, you still see that as an issue.
Exactly. And I do not have permission to do anything with that property.
Okay.
I'm only an administrator, just like Kathy is only an administrator.
Okay. Anything else you wish me to know?
There's also the fact that there was someone else the day my stepfather died that owned the property. That was brought up in a hearing a couple of years ago. We've been dealing with this since 2014.
What other individual was involved that you're speaking of there?
The day my stepfather died, Miss Patricia Barlow Ivory was living in that home and had been making mortgage payments to him since 2000. So if he had a will, he couldn't have left it to her. Because there's an agreement. It's in my objection. It's recorded in the records room.
Okay.
That was brought up. That needs to be addressed. And you know, I just kind of got to the appellate state because I'm just going around and around in this courthouse from my mother's estate. We've lost everything in my mother's estate, probably due to what was going on in my stepfather's estate. I have no idea why all this was done, why it wasn't put back into his name. I've heard it was never put in his name right to begin with. I don't know why that was done. I can't answer that question.
Okay, right.
Kathy should be able to answer that question, but where was she for 2 years?
Well, and that's what our hearing is going to be for when we have the final hearing. That's exactly what.
The bottom line was, I have filed a lien on money I have paid out of my own pocket for taxes, tax liens, bills. Has she done any of that? No.
Okay, I understand your claim is
messy down here, Your Honor.
This
gets me very upset.
Well, we don't want to
because
have
we're avoiding the elephant in the room. Nobody wants to talk about what happened.
Well, we will get to that, but not today.
So my point is, I have filed a lien. I have contacted Medicaid fraud. That's how Ms. O'Toole got involved, because for the life of me, I could not figure out why this was done, how it was done, what purpose, and something just clicked. And I called the nursing home where my stepfather passed away to make sure, because I had paid all the bills of both my mother and my stepfather that Medicare didn't pay, and other tax liens, property taxes and stuff, to preserve what was left, the only thing left of any hope of me getting back money, not an inheritance that I lost, money I spent out of my pocket to bury my mother. You understand what I'm trying to say?
I do.
And I do know that if my stepfather were alive the day my mother died, he would have buried her. You would bury your wife, you would bury your husband. That's all I was ever after. My lien does not prevent the sale of that property. My objection to that leave of sale is the only thing preventing that sale. Ms. O'Toole's lien our Attorney General's office, who she represents, does not prevent the sale of that property. The liens are paid, and if there's $50 left over, that's not my problem. That's Kathy's problem.
Well, one of the things, Ms. Nichols, we're going to address is how we get to the bottom line. And one of those things is I'm trying to decide the issues. Do you disagree with a $25,000 sales price?
I've had multiple offers from people when I was acting as administrator for both estates for $40,000 or more.
Okay.
My mother was
okay.
selling it before
okay.
she...
I'm making a note in my notes that you disagree with the sales price, okay?
Well, I don't really disagree. Is that the only offer? I mean, she doesn't communicate with me, so.
Okay.
And Kevin Talent won't
communicate
with me.
For now, it will remain an issue that the $25,000, you may disagree because you say that you've had offers of $40,000. So we'll leave that as an issue, okay?
You need to maximize the estate, not type it away through court documents.
All right.
Unnecessary court documents, by the way.
All right. Well, let's address just a few issues if we could. And y'all understand the purpose of the hearing is I want to expedite this as much as we can, identify the issues as clearly as we can. Each side needs to know what the issues are and what we're going to address at this hearing. And Ms. Nichols, you're greatly disadvantaged in not having an attorney. And I would, you're...
If I may, Your Honor.
Don't interrupt me, please, ma'am. I would advise very strongly that you get an attorney to represent you through these matters. They're complicated, and a lot of the issues could be explained through that attorney. In fact, the executor's deed has a title searching aspect to it. The lien that the Department of Community Health has filed has a title aspect to it. Of course, the title's got to be clear before it's sold. The lease purchase agreement with Ms. Ivy, that has a title aspect that's got to be clear before it's sold. So what I want to do is divide those issues from what we're talking about and really get down to the point of whether the property should be sold or not. The money must be used to pay all the debts before there's any distribution, of course. So if we could go with those goals in mind, I would be very appreciative of it. Has there been any discussion of mediation, and would that hold any possibility of success? And let me explain, Ms. Nichols, the mediation would be a trained mediator. It could be at your choice, as you might agree, or I would select a mediator. And a mediator would not represent either one of you. A mediator would go through that process, which would be try to get all the facts on the table, hear from you, hear from both sides, and then try to come to some resolution that lists the issues and then resolves those issues. So I throw that out there in the hopes that there would be some consideration toward that. I got back from a seminar yesterday, and one of the Superior Court judges' advice was, is when she sits on cases, is that she tells folks, y'all are taking this family matter, in this case, and turning it over to a complete stranger, when family members might consider the table, maybe with the help of a mediator, and resolve things before you turn it over to the third party, the court, meaning me in this instance. So with that, is there any hope of any mediation? Would that be of any benefit that y'all might want to pursue?
Your Honor, in 99% of the cases that we work on, I would say yes, we would be agreeable to mediation. In this case, I'm not sure that it would be a productive measure. During the Superior Court case, we had an extensive amount of time spent on settlement negotiations, and we thought we came to agreements on several occasions, and then at the last minute, those would fall through. So in the interest of not wasting more fees for the estate, we're open to it if Ms. Nichols is open to it and committed to it, but we would need some sort of reassurance that it would be something worthwhile to do.
Let me explain a little bit more for Ms. Nichols. It is a process that does not require you to accept the discussion. The mediator will go from party to party, determine the issues, and try to resolve the situation. if you don't want to settle it on the facts as presented to you, as Ms. Freeman might present through the mediator, you don't have to. If you do agree, it will be written down and it will be binding, okay? So is there some thought, Ms. Nichols, that you might want to pursue mediation?
Your Honor, we have been in court for years. There is no chance of mediating anything.
Okay, that's all I need to know. No, okay.
And my answer to that would be, I would withdraw the, if you're saying that this property is back in Mr. Pruitt's name.
I have not resolved all of that. I am told that there was a deed that was set aside from your mother's name back to his estate. If that is the, is that the situation?
Yes, Your Honor.
If that is.
So my understanding would be that would relieve me of having to sign or give or convey permission to the court, because it's taken that out of my hands. That's how I would understand that.
This has been filed on behalf of the petitioner seeking permission of the court to sell the property for $25,000. They have given you notice, and on that basis, you have a right to object to that sale, which you have done. Now we're going to set the rules to head toward a hearing to determine whether that sale is appropriate or not. Ms. Nichols, I don't have authority to say whether a lien filed in the deed records is good or not. Your lien, community health, I would address. I can address it in the probate court context, but in terms of how it affects the title to sale, that's the title examiners to decide that, as well as the agreement with Ms. Ivey, please understand.
I understand that, Your Honor, and that's what should have happened a long time ago. There should have been a special master appointed to find out who actually owns the land while this was done. But if they want to sell the land for $28,000, that's fine. I get paid, Department of Health gets paid, we're done. They don't need my permission to do that.
You
don't need a court's permission to decide any of that. It's already decided in the sale.
No, ma'am. They have filed a petition to sell it. You've objected. You have a right to object. And then I hear from both sides, and when we enter the formal hearing, then I'll decide whether their petition is appropriate or whether your objection is good. And I'll either allow or disallow that sale at that time. So you do have a voice in it. But if you're consenting today to a sale of $25,000, that could
and
resolve
withdraw my objection, yes.
And withdraw your objection, yes, ma'am.
And then whatever's left over, they can, that's not my problem.
They will have to go through the, as the code requires, in terms of priority of who gets paid before anybody gets anything, correct, Ms. Anderson?
Yes, Your Honor, and the lien does complicate that matter.
Does.
We would have to file a slander of title action, and we're prepared to do so if we need to. We're hoping to save those costs for the estate because it just reduces the amount that the heirs will receive.
I'm sorry, you're going to file what type of action?
Slander of title.
Okay.
In essence, Your Honor, filing a lien, we don't believe that Ms. Nichols has standing, and so it's an attempt to step over the order of payments that are set forth by statute for probate cases.
I understand. And let me, Ms. Nichols, let me divide the issues just a little bit. Our status conference here, for which I've got pretrial orders and all that stuff ready to go, is to decide that first issue, sell the property. If you consent to it, then we go to the next issues, which is the administration after the sale of the property, if they can get the title clear. Am I looking at that correctly?
I believe so, Your Honor,
yes. Why wasn't the title clear before they... I don't understand what you're saying, Your Honor.
Okay. If there are title objections, it will be handled by the closing attorney who certifies to the buyer, whomever it might be, that these issues are resolved in agreement with community health, your lien, any other liens that might be filed. I understand there's a difference in liens. You've got one against real estate, which affects the title, and you've got a claim of lien that's filed in probate court. And it's two different things, right?
I have one lien. They have two. I don't have a claim in probate court.
Okay. Let me back up to our two issues. The first is, we're working hard to determine the framework under which the petition to sell filed will be handled, okay? Is it your agreement that you now withdraw your objection and you consent to the sale for $25,000? Now, you're leaving the title problems for them, you understand?
I thought the sale was $28,000.
Your Honor, the sale is for $28,000.
I'm sorry, my bad, $28,000.
However, the net proceeds to the estate would be about $25,000, considering closing costs and other costs.
But, Your Honor, the buyer is paying the closing costs. That's in the agreement. The buyer's paying the closing costs.
Your Honor, I don't want to keep repeating what I've said, but we've got the details in our petition.
Okay. Let me back up.
I'm sorry, there's something I haven't seen then.
Let me back up just a little bit. Let me change everything to $28,000, which is a better deal. Okay. They file a petition to sell it. You've got a right to object. You have objected. Nobody can force anything on you today, Ms. Nichols. This is just a status conference. However, if it is an opportunity where you withdraw your objection, then we can enter that on the record that you withdraw your objection, and then she will handle, Ms. Freeman will handle the estate as the law requires her to do. But that's your choice today. Nothing can be forced on you today.
Your Honor, what else is left to handle? The estate, to sell the property. Sell the property, pay the liens, and we're done. That's as simple as that.
Sell the property and follow the code as to who gets paid how much, yes?
No, Your Honor, that would be in a probate matter, distributing what's there.
Yes, ma'am.
There isn't anything there. What is owed out of my pocket, which I'm rightfully owed that money, and as Medicaid is rightfully owed that money, sue me, sue slander of title. What? Where is slander in that? That should have been addressed when Spencer Duckett drafted that. And I know you don't want to hear that, but.
I have no knowledge of what you're talking about. All I'm saying is that we can think of it in at least two steps. The first is petition to sell. Do you disagree with that, or do you withdraw your objection? Second stage is there's a sale at some point that's got to clear all these title objections. And if it does, then it enters the process where the administrator or personal representative will then distribute it the way the law requires. So I'm just trying to get past step one. Ms. Nichols, I can't get all the way to step two because I don't know all the facts of that yet. Okay?
And that's unfortunate that we're here yet at another hearing and there's three heirs missing. And
well, technically, the administrator or personal representative is acting for the estate. So
I understand. She needs to be removed. So.
Well, that's a separate action.
Exactly.
And I don't have that before me.
The shortest distance to this finish line that I so desperately want, I've been in court for 6 years and 2 months now. And Kathy knows that. I was in a horrible custody battle when my parents died and lost the only family I had. And I have been dealing with this forever. I don't have a right to those. Let me ask you this. Where would that property be today had I not paid those taxes and those liens? Since her brother didn't tell her of that, how would she have found out about that?
Ms. Nichols, none of those issues can be decided today. They can be litigated later if you want to bring it up. If it is admissible and if it's germane to the points that I must decide. But let me return, please. Do you maintain your objection to the sale, the petition to sell for $28,000, or do you withdraw?
For the amount of sale?
Do you agree for the $28,000? They're just seeking permission of the court. forward to sell it.
I understand what they're asking.
Right.
I would be willing to withdraw that objection. That is preventing the sale of the property.
Okay.
But my lien would stay in place, and I would get paid, and the Department of Health would get paid. Whatever's left over, that's not on me. That's their problem.
If your objection is withdrawn, I'm making no decision on who gets paid out of the proceeds. That would be at a later time.
Then I don't know why we're here.
We're here to decide the framework to set a hearing on their petition to sell. Okay? I don't want to decide matters that are not before me right now. All I've got is we're setting the framework to set a hearing to decide whether the petition to sell should be granted.
So we're just going to continuously?
We're going to do as the law requires, Ms. Nichols, to give you a full day in court to be able to object on legal grounds to what they have filed to do.
You've asked me about attorneys. Do you have any clue how many attorneys I've hired?
That's up to you, Ms. Nichols. I'm just advising them.
Basically working for them, so.
Well, I'm just telling you that it's always advantageous to have an attorney in court. It's just.
I've done my best. I think 40 is about enough. So.
Okay. Okay.
Kathy and I had an agreement, and her three brothers, before Kevin Talent's law firm ever got involved. Kathy knows.
Okay.
What our agreement is.
Okay, we're not, if we're not agreed, I'm not getting into the particulars of who claims what or who said what at a particular time. To be repetitive, but I want to be clear, you maintain your objection for the $28,000 sales price?
Yes.
You do? Okay. That is fine. All right. Y'all please understand, and Ms. Nichols, please understand, I'm not being abrupt or curt when I can't talk to you when you call the office. I don't talk to anybody when they call the office when I'm sitting as a judge, so. Don't interrupt me, please, ma'am. Please understand that there are rules, and I don't want to talk to anybody except in a court setting with all people present. So please don't take that wrong. I had my secretary call you back and okay the court reporter. And advise you on that, but please understand when I don't call you back, it's nothing personal. I'm not slighting you. I just don't talk to anybody before we get to court. This is the only place where I do that.
I understand that, Your Honor, and I never attempted to be.
Oh, no, I'm not saying you did. I'm just saying when I did not call you back, that's why.
I understand.
You got it? Okay. All right. I will take some time and study the summary judgment as entered on the land, but on the face of it, it seems to be appropriate because there was no will that left everything to your mother. It should have been shared equally, and that's one thing that I picked up when I went through the file, that it was there were several heirs of law that were involved. So, if we might, a couple of basic questions. Is there a mobile home involved on the land?
If I could just check with my client.
Sure.
This is structure.
Permanent structure.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
We have handled, I had made a list of the issues, but we've handled most of those. One thing that I would like Ms. Anderson to address, I did see Judge Campbell's order, and at that time there apparently wasn't any real estate. He said there didn't need to be a bond. Now there is real estate and there's been a bond for 25, but I think Ms. Nichols might be right. It needs to be twice the amount of the land.
Your Honor, we do have a bond for $25,000. If we need to increase it, we'll work on that. And we are filing an amended bond today just to correct a typo and to see its name, but we'll look into that.
Well, look into that, and if it's not double, let me know. But Ms. Nichols has presented the position of double, and we will pursue that. We have handled what I had written down about the executor's deed that apparently has been set aside. We talked about Ms. Nichols' lien. We talked about the community health lien. What I have here, and I would like for y'all to look at it, And y'all can both approach if you'd like to, Ms. Nichols and Ms. Anderson. Ms. Anderson will be very familiar with this. This is just a pretrial order form, Ms. Nichols, and this is just simply to help us be able to set a time and let me know how much time the client planned for a hearing. And what I'd like to do is give you the chance to look at that, and we're going to review it, and I'd like to get as much of it completed today as we can. And then we'll seek to set a hearing sometime, probably in November. Y'all have been litigating a long time. I'll do my best to meet with your schedule so that we can do this as quickly as we can. So if y'all want to take a look at this pretrial order form, we'll just hit some basics here, and then we will present it there. If y'all want to take a seat, please.
Thank you.
Ms. Anderson, how long from your side of the case, how long do you anticipate it taking?
Your Honor, are we just discussing the petition for leave to sell?
Are there any other issues at this point?
I don't think there are any other. I mean, unless we need to file the slander of title action, but assuming that we just need to do the to argue the petition for leave to sell, I would think that we could handle our side within 3 hours. We'll need some time to rebut.
Okay. All right, Ms. Nichols, about how long for your side of the case, please, ma'am? We're just trying to...
3 hours, how about that? I'll just answer which. I've been through all this before.
Okay. Well, we'll just start in the morning, and we can, with what's been told me, we can get concluded in a day. Are there, under this story, are there any other motions or any other matters pending for consideration at this time?
There will be.
There will be, but they're not now.
No, I'm we'll file a motion to have her removed.
Well, I don't have that before me now, so I can't decide that now.
You know.
But they're not going to be just motions filed throughout. If there's anything to be filed, 10 days to be filed. That'll be by the 15th. Making a note, any other motions to be filed by 10:15. Okay, I'll look to Ms. Anderson for five to be completed as to petitioner front plaintiff's brief and succinct outline. And Ms. Nichols, I'll look for you to complete six so you can give me an outline of what your position is, please. Seven would be for the issues for each of you to set out for me as you see them. Pretty straightforward. Should the petition for sale be granted or not? So unless there are other issues, that will be what I will be deciding. I suspect that it would be very complicated to come up with stipulated facts within paragraph 8, so I'm assuming that there probably aren't any, unless y'all can state some.
I think we'll probably have separate factual statements, Your Honor.
Okay. So with that, would mean there are no stipulations?
Yes.
Okay. It is very helpful, Ms. Nichols, beforehand, if there are any documentary or physical evidence under this paragraph 9, it really helps my job, and it helps each of y'all, I think, too, to tell me if you have any physical or documentary evidence beforehand. Identify them, show it to the other party, and if there's no objection, we have streamlined the process. If there is an objection, it allows me the opportunity to look at that before court and decide whether it's admissible or not. So I'm directing that each of you on this paragraph 9 complete that as to any documentary or physical evidence that you wish to have. And that way we'll have a cleaner process when we do have the hearing today. Special authorities are in paragraph 10. I expect there probably aren't any other than the reference to the code section on the petition to sell on both sides, 10 and 11. Are there any persons whose testimony will be introduced by deposition?
No, Your Honor.
Yes, Your Honor.
Has the deposition already been taken?
No.
presented. I'll put for 12-9 unless. Deposition taken before 10-15. 17. And that allows you, Ms. Nichols, you got 10 days if you want to take some discovery. You can take a deposition within 10 days, and then that would be promptly filed with the court. Now, 13 is really important because Ms. Nichols, just to explain this, there are situations in litigation where each side may depend on the other side having certain persons present in court. So there's a distinction here in this paragraph 13. Plaintiff, meaning Ms. Freeman, will have present. She'll say who she will have present. You can count on that. If she has, may have present and they don't show up, they don't have to be here. If you want them here, you need to use the subpoena power of the court and you get them here. Okay, so I'm asking Ms. Anderson to present to me on behalf of Ms. Freeman who they will have present at trial, who they may have. I'm asking you to do the same thing, please, that you will have present and then that you may have present. But it is very helpful for everyone to know who will be testifying at this hearing, and we will have a lot better hold on what the testimony will be and how long it might take. Are there any questions?
This is a pretrial order.
Yes, ma'am.
For objection to leave of cell.
Yes.
And we're going to go through all of my objections.
Yes, ma'am.
In there.
Yes, ma'am.
And this is what this is trial. Then you're saying there would be other things that you're going to sort out in other hearings, like to clear the title.
The clearing title is not up to me. That is a real estate attorney. That's a title insurance company. I can't say whether the title is good or not. I can look at deeds and I can, of course, based on what the court has said in Superior Court, it's being presented to me that it's owned by this estate and that they're seeking to sell it. I haven't heard anything from you that says they don't have the deed or they don't have the right to sell.
I haven't seen anything giving them the right to sell that property.
Well, she will give you.
Shouldn't I have a copy of that?
They don't have the right to sell it yet because that's the issue before the court. What I'm asking Ms. Anderson to do is present you with a copy of the summary judgment, which vests title back in the estate by my understanding. And she'll give you a copy of that. If you have any objection to that, that is the time to raise it now under these special authorities and positions in this pretrial order.
Just so we're clear, Your Honor, my objection that was filed, is that property downstairs, or we're downstairs, I'm sorry, in that deed room is still in my mother's name. In her estate, which there is no estate, property was never listed. It's still in her name. I want to see something saying that it is put back into his estate in a deed form. Then that relieves me of having to deal with any of this. Because I can't give her permission to do something that I don't have permission to do myself. She doesn't have permission to sell that property. That's why she's petitioned the court. She also doesn't have permission to bring a lawsuit against me. The motion for summary judgment, she didn't have the proper authority to bring that lawsuit against me. She was never granted those powers to do that.
Okay, let me help you with this and you'll get a copy of it. This is in the Superior Court lawsuit. By virtue of the harm suffered by the estate of Lemuel Pruitt as a result of the wrongful transfer of the real property, the plaintiff is entitled to have the deed conveying real property from the estate to Judy Farmer Pruitt set aside. Such will return the property to the estate where it is subject to administration under Georgia law, to include being subject to the payment of debts, expenses of administration, and ultimately distribution to the heirs. So that's what sets the deed aside unless it was appealed.
You're talking about Judge Caldwell's order that I did appeal. Yes, I would.
Appeal it to whom?
I appealed it. What is that dated?
This is dated August 29, 2016.
Yes, I filed an appeal.
To whom?
To the Supreme Court.
Your Honor, that appeal was filed and then subsequently dismissed. The order on motion for summary judgment is final since the appeal has been dismissed.
If you have anything otherwise, Ms. Nichols, I'm glad to consider
my question.
Don't interrupt me.
I'm sorry. Okay.
If you have anything counter to that, I'm glad to consider that. It's reported by Ms. Anderson that your appeal was dismissed. That means this order is effective. I'm glad to consider it. If you have other information, I'm glad to consider it. But that's what's being reported to me.
So
now,
okay, Your Honor, sorry.
Yes, ma'am.
So that right there constitutes a deed.
Yes, ma'am.
Just as the executor's deed.
Conveys title.
Okay. And who conveyed that deed into their that estate?
The court order did it.
Okay.
It
Who conveyed that deed into my mother's name?
By the executor's deed that you attached to your
Who actually conveyed that property?
Judy Farmer Pruitt is executor of the last will and testament of Lemuel Thay Pruitt.
What last will and testament?
Exactly.
What law firm did my mother work for? What law school did she graduate from?
None of those issues matter, Ms. Nichols. If you have some objection, legal objection, that challenges Judge Caudill's order, which sets the property back into the estate of Mr. Pruitt, I'm glad to consider it. Anything else is immaterial and I don't need to hear it.
Well, I understand. I did that, got right back in front of the court because Judge Rigman is the one that landed the appeal in the Court of Appeals. So here I am. I have no other choice to withdraw. I can't keep going in front of the same court and getting the same result. We were supposed to have a jury trial, took that away from me. I want this resolved. I don't want anything else to do with this, yet here we are doing a pretrial. I've explained it.
Yeah, you understand, people come with complex problems, Ms. Nichols, and the court has got to find all these difficulties and problems, both legal and personal and otherwise, and it has to fit in a filter. And the law is not perfect, but it filters through in a system that we know what the rules are. We know what the rules of evidence are. We know what the rules of the state administration are. We know what the rules of real property are. And that's what we're trying to do here. And please understand that this status conference today is simply to set these rules out so we get to an orderly result that's based on the facts and the law. I'm not trying to put anything off. This is the first thing I've ever heard of this case. So let's go step by step and let's fit it in this process. If you want to stop the proceedings and pull out, we will provide the framework or it will be done. But you have a right to be heard, and that's the only reason we're here, is giving you the right to be heard, which we are allowing the framework to do.
But you're not letting me be heard today.
Because this is not for evidence. This is simply to set the framework through a pretrial order. If you had an attorney representing you, he or she would say, okay, Ms. Nichols, this is where we tell the judge about who we're going to have witnesses, how many we're going to have. We need to get subpoenas. These are the issues. There's a motion pending. I need to get it before the judge. This is just simply a housekeeping thing to set the hearing. This is not the hearing itself, okay? I haven't heard any expert testimony or otherwise from Ms. Freeman. It's not the time for it. So understand, we're coming back because you have filed an objection and we want to give you your day in court on that. You're entitled to it.
And you agree with all the issues of the title being clouded? Not.
I'm telling you that is another ballpark. If the lawyer that checks the title says the title's clear and has the necessary documentation from community health and from you or from whomever, that's a title issue. I have a single issue. Are they petitioning to sell at a fair market value, reasonable price that's acceptable to me as the court? That's all I decide. That's all I decide. Other issues come later. What bills get paid, how the money is distributed, that's another issue.
Is that before you, Your Honor, or does that go back in front of Judge?
I think everything's standing before me, unless someone says otherwise. I think I have the entire case.
Because it was my understanding 3-4 years ago that Judge Campbell was the judge in this case.
I have no idea. I just know that I have been requested to sit, and I have agreed to sit. It would be inappropriate to hear all these things, Ms. Nichols, because I don't know if I'm going to grant them the power to sell. Why would we address to sell? Why would I address all these other issues if they don't even have the power to sell yet? We do these things in an orderly progression.
She never had the power to bring a motion for summary judgment against me.
She apparently did. It was granted. She apparently did.
There was also a deed transferred.
Yes, ma'am. Well, please understand, I know you're frustrated. I know it's been a long time. I'm only here to set a hearing and use this time together to arrive at that hearing date so we can move forward and hear on this single issue. If it's not granted, then they start all over again. If it's granted, then they'll follow through the code as to the disbursement of the proceeds, including community health or whoever else might be involved. So, do you have any questions? I can't represent you or give you any advice, but are there any form questions on the pretrial order that you have?
I truly believe if Kathy and I could sit down and talk this out, that we could get this resolved.
I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
It's okay. This court has created this mess that nobody wants to touch and nobody wants to unravel. This should have been handled when the correct way when my stepfather died, and then of course the correct way when my mother died. If Mike Pruitt knew this, where were y'all for 2 years? That's the question I want to know.
Well, that is why I mentioned at the outset, Ms. Nichols, is mediation a possibility? I heard it from both sides.
Well,
no.
Kathy and I have tried to do that. Kevin Talon has only created conflict between us.
Let's stick to the format of getting set for a hearing here fairly quickly. If there's some opportunity that the door has been open for mediation or discussion, I've been doing this a long time, lawyering and otherwise, I urge you to take every opportunity to do that. It's expensive, it's time consuming, it's emotionally draining to everybody. If there's any opportunity to do that, I certainly recommend that y'all do that. Can y'all tell me any times in November, if we try to get some closing date set, any days that y'all cannot have a hearing in November? I know y'all will probably have a busy court schedule, but I just need to know what might suit y'all before we bat a lot of dates around.
Your Honor, I could give you my schedule pretty quickly, but I know Mr. Talent would like to be here for any hearing on this matter. If I could get a 2-minute recess maybe to call my office and see what dates would work for him.
Why don't we do this, and this might help Ms. Nichols too. She might need to check her calendar too. Why don't we say by next Friday, each of y'all tell me what times in November would be a conflict where you could not be present for this day hearing?
Your Honor, I don't think we finished the question a second ago.
Let me knock this out and we'll get to your point, okay?
Okay.
By next Friday, which will be 18th, is that correct? By the 18th, y'all please let me know what conflicts you have in November. I will coordinate my schedule with each of yours, and then we will set a hearing. And we'll start at 9 o'clock in the morning, and we'll stay as long as necessary.
Thank you.
Okay, does that make sense, Ms. Nichols? You okay with that?
I'm fine with that, Your Honor, but if we could finish the question I asked before.
Okay. If it's
Kathy and I are working this out as promised in the very first hearing we had.
Let me address that just a second. Two things by next Friday. Get the November conflicts to me and get the pretrial order returned from your side. And I will consolidate the pretrial order with whatever y'all say. Please provide copies to the other, so Ms. Nichols, you'll know who their witnesses are. And Ms. Freeman, you'll know who Ms. Nichols' witnesses are. We'll know beforehand. So Friday week, next Friday, the 18th, will be the deadline for that. Ms. Nichols, I can order mediation if you think it's helpful. I've heard that it was not a very positive possibility from the petitioner's side. Nothing prevents y'all from talking and trying to work this out.
Your Honor, I agree. Kathy and I have no reason to not work this out. We tried our best for months to get this. How do you fix a deed that's messed up like that?
You go to court and get it set aside.
Well,
and that's what they did.
You're not letting me, okay.
You go ahead, I'm sorry.
You're not letting me have my day in court. I've wanted that forever, so.
Well, please understand, Ms. Nichols, the whole purpose of this hearing is giving your day in court, giving you your day in court. We're just not here to have testimony today. That's what I made clear to everybody. It's what I said in my letter. It is simply to lay the roadmap out for an orderly hearing where each side gets to present her side fully and completely.
And the other three heirs are where?
Again, that's up to them whether to hear or not. The estate is represented. The estate has their attorney.
Your Honor, I may, she does not represent the estate. She represents Kathy. Kevin Talent doesn't represent the estate of Lemuel Pruitt. That is not true. He only represents Kathy Freeman. She can't speak for the other three Pruitt heirs. I have that in numerous writings from him. He only represents Kathy Freeman.
He represents her as petitioner in this estate, and she serves as personal representative.
But he doesn't represent the estate, from my understanding.
If those are issues you wish addressed, please put them in the pretrial order. There will be special issues for decision. Please set them out so I will understand them clearly, and I will be glad to take them one by one. So, are we clear on the 18th? The deadline is for y'all to get, each of you, to give me your conflicts for the month of November. And then also to have a completed pretrial order. I will consolidate it, and I will send copies to each of you.
We're not clear on the question I asked a while ago.
Which one?
About Kathy and I working this.
If you want to get together and work it out, I would encourage it. I'm not going to order it because that requires mediation, which requires $200 to $300 an hour for a mediator. But nothing keeps y'all or prevents you from speaking with each other to work it out. And I'm sure Ms. Anderson or Mr. Talon would want to be present for that. I leave that to y'all. That is not a court matter for me to decide. That's a family matter. Now, is there anything else we need to address that I have failed to?
Your Honor, I do have something when the court's ready.
I'm ready.
I believe this estate has been pending for quite some time. I think the discovery period in this estate would be over. And I know the court has stated that any depositions that are taken by October 15th would be allowed, but I can't imagine that there are any depositions that would not be of somebody who could also attend the hearing and present testimony that way. So in efforts to keep the estate costs down and avoid 7-hour depositions, I would request that discovery be closed and that we not allow any further depositions unless a witness is unavailable under the evidence rules.
Okay, any objection to that, Ms. Nichols?
I agree that there's a lot of things that can't be done in 10 days. But again, this is unnecessary litigation. We shouldn't even be in this courtroom today. This should have been settled years ago.
Is there any objection to Ms. Anderson's request that discovery be closed unless the person cannot be here?
I object to that. I need to have my evidence in discovery.
And you can have them here at the hearing?
I can't say that. I've subpoenaed many people to this court that the court's just ignored. So, you want me to give you an honest answer on that?
How long has this motion been pending?
Since the beginning of August.
shows, let me look them up. Is there a filing date, Ms. Anderson?
Your Honor, I don't have the exact filing date with me, but I do believe it was sometime in August or late summer.
I had to file my answer by the 9th of August.
Okay, so it's very... All right, let's drop back to the deposition issue. That's the kind of thing we're supposed to handle here. Is there any testimony you wish to seek to present by deposition?
In reference to the title of the land and everything in my objection.
And I understand it would be a separate deposition that attorneys would be present. Is the six-month discovery rule going to apply? Are we going to have to wait 6 months? Would you waive the 6 months discovery?
No.
Would that not be present in this case?
Your Honor, I don't believe we would need an additional six months. I'm not sure that it applies for this petition, but we don't want to arbitrarily cut off any discovery rights for Ms. Nichols. We're not here to do that. Our purpose is merely just to cut down the cost for the estate. I'm sure Ms. Nichols knows this already, but if we conduct depositions, you know, we will end up having to work on the costs for a court reporter, and that doesn't all go to the estate. Some of that will go to the party requesting depositions as well.
Ms. Nichols, there's normally a six-month period of discovery. That's where people send interrogatories, written questions to the other party. They answer them back. If they're not answered sufficiently, you can file a motion with the judge to make them answer. There's a deposition where you sit down with the court reporter, you take people's testimony. You have 6 months to do that. Do you want the full 6 months for you to have those rights to help present your case, or do you wish to allow this case to proceed to a quicker hearing?
If we're going to try, I want my 6 months. That's been taken completely away from me every time.
Yeah, I wish time to respond by brief or whatever to her request.
Yes, Your Honor, we can get that to you by next Friday if we need to. I would just like to consult with Mr. Talent and make sure I'm not overstepping any boundaries here since he's lead counsel in this case.
Okay. It would appear that is the central issue right now, Ms. Nichols, is that if you want the full 6 months discovery, that will delay further hearing. It will delay my involvement in the case for a period of 6 months from the date of filing. So, and go as the code provides. So, I will drop out of the picture for that period of time. Please file your pleadings properly with the court. If I'm needed on any interim matters of discovery, please let me know. I will be glad to be available. If it is appropriate that the 6 months discovery remains and there's nothing contra coming from the petitioner, there's no need to have the November conflicts notice to me. There's no need to complete the pretrial order.
Good.
If we're going on a 6 months basis, we will have a formal pretrial conference next time. It won't be a status conference because I know more about the case now. I understand the various positions, and we'll go straight to a pretrial conference with a pretrial order issuing after that. And you will both, Ms. Nichols, you'll be familiar with the process at that point.
This will be in probate, not superior. You need nothing by next week.
I don't need anything
next week.
Okay. If you would, Ms. Anderson, whatever response you give to me on the 6 months discovery by brief or letter brief or whatever, please send Ms. Nichols a copy, and you will have 10 days after receiving that to respond if you disagree with her.
So disregard this. And we're starting trial all over again.
We're allowing you the time, the statutory time to conduct discovery.
I understand, just as though we were in Superior Court.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And we are on what calendar? What court calendar?
Probate Court.
No, no, the calendar. Is it from July to... Because that was the, see, remember we got confused and all that, we were on the wrong court calendar. I got served and then all of a sudden we were in the middle of hearing when depositions and discovery and all that wasn't even completed. I'm just trying to make sure.
Let me help a little bit. When 6 months from the date of filing or the 6 months discovery period expires, we will, I'll pick a date 5 months out, 6 months out, and then we'll coordinate a hearing time. We have no other calendar, no other schedules to worry about. Y'all's calendar, your calendar, and my calendar, and we'll, and the courtroom calendar, and we will set it as quickly as we can after that 6 months.
Okay.
Okay. Any questions?
No, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Thank you for your presence.
Do you have extra copies of the motion for summary judgment order, Ms. Nichols?
I have a copy of that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Your Honor, may we be excused?
Well, sir, thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Your Honor.
And if y'all can't get together to discuss the settlement, I encourage you to do it.
Thank you.
That would be most helpful. Thank you.
The video will be available on my YouTube channel.
Okay.
And thank you for your permission.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you very much.